Start. I will share my screen. Please do not hesitate to tell me if it's not working as expected. Is that okay?
Yep.
Okay, and you hear me well, obviously. So first, I would like to thank the organizer for inviting me to give this talk, which is based on recent results we have obtained with X-ray nanobeam imaging approaches using both coherent and coherent X-ray beam. And these studies were done in order to gain physicochemistry insight on calcareous biomineralization. So welcome, everybody. So as an introduction to the fascinating world of biominerals, I have gathered here several examples of calcareous biominerals, which are these hard tissues with amazing shape and architectures built by living organisms to answer to specific needs. So these highly regulated and complex organomineral structures raised, of course, the interest of material science. So this is exemplified here with enamel, which is composed of single crystalline nanowire bundled in rods themselves arranged in 3D wave. Another striking example is shown here with the famous pearl oyster shell, which is able at the same time to produce different crystalline polymorph, aragonite and calcite, both of them being arranged into specific three-dimensional arrangements. So these structural properties and architectural properties provide, of course, some very interesting mechanical properties to the biominerals, such as an enhanced resistance to damage. And another example here is given with nacre, which is able to boost bone regeneration. So here we understand the interest of developing biomimetism approaches to develop biomimetic materials. Paleoclimatology also relies a lot on biominerals because the production of the shell of various species is able or is influenced by their environmental conditions, such as water temperature or water acidity. So foraminifera, for instance, they can be used as paleothermometer through the measurement of magnesium, a trace element with respect to the carbonate calcium contained into the carbonate shell. However, in order to derive an empirical law describing the relationship between the magnesium-calcium ratio and the water temperature, one needs to develop an extensive set of calibration, of experimental calibration. So this underlines the fact that magnesium incorporation is not well understood, and in particular, the intra- and interspecies magnesium variability, which is observed and shown here, for instance, which shows that the understanding of the role of this trace element is not very clear. And finally, as a last example of the importance of these calcareous biominerals, let me remind you that calcium carbonate is one of the most prominent minerals on the Earth's crust, and therefore it plays a major role into the global carbon cycle. So in order to better understand the fine details of the carbon cycle, we need to be able to describe the physicochemical pathways which are experienced by biomineralization processes. So as you can see, as soon as you are interested by biominerals, the questions of biomineralization is not very far. So this talk is focusing on the Pinctada margaritifera species, which is the famous pearl oyster shell. And these species have been chosen for different reasons, one of them being shown here. The outer layer of the shell is presenting characteristics that is present in several different biomineralizing species. So here on this optical microscopy image, you can see the structure of the outer shell layer, and you can see different units, which are called prisms, that are composing the outer shell layer. If you look now with cross-polarized light microscopy approaches, you can see that these units exhibit homogeneous colors, which is a characteristic of a single crystalline-like behavior. This is even more striking here with an X-ray beam, where you can see here the X-ray diffraction pattern corresponding to an overall prisms. And you can see that the diffraction pattern exhibits well-identified and isolated Bragg peaks, a characteristic of a single crystalline-like behavior. However, if you look now at a much closer scale, if you look at a submicrometric scale, the structure at the submicrometric scale, you can see a structure which is far from a single crystalline characteristic. The structure is composed of organomineral granules, which clearly shows that the biomineralization of such a species is escaping from classical crystallization pathways. So in order to progress in our understanding of biomineralization, in vitro synthesis have been performed in order to produce large single crystal from solution. So in the classical crystallization theory, a single crystal is obtained after the formation of an initial nucleus, which is growing further by the addition of successive single species and monomer. However, in vitro synthesis and also ex vivo observation have shown that crystallization can be much more complex when it is performed under the mediation of organic molecules. So it can involve the presence of complexes and oligomers. It can also be based on the formation of nanocrystalline units, which will attach onto specific crystalline faces in order to produce these bulk crystals. Or it can also be based on the occurrence of an intermediate amorphous phases, a precursor amorphous phase, which will further transform into a single crystals. So here, this figures shows you the importance of gathering both crystalline and chemical information if you want to progress on the understanding of biomineralization. And of course, these are information that X-rays can provide. So in this talk, as I said, I will focus on the pearl oyster shell, and I will show you first the strategy we have used or we have developed to progress on the understanding of this calcareous biomineralization. Then I will show you two kind of results, one concerning chemical analysis, and the second kind of results regarding crystalline properties. So let's start with the presentation of our strategy. And in order to do that, I need to refer again to this famous figure. And as you can see here, in order to progress on the understanding of biomineralization, you do not only need crystalline and chemical information, but more important, or as important, you need also to get some temporal information. You need to get temporal information to understand what are the different transition the system is going through. So of course, in order to do that, the ideal strategy is an in vivo approaches, and we are making effort into that direction. You can see here a first test we have done with optical microscopy on a living shell. These in vivo approaches are extremely challenging, and they must verify two kinds of conditions. So first, the experimental setup must be compatible with the animal living conditions by definition. And also the gathered information must be spatially resolved and quantitative. So here, in the case of the pearl oyster shell, we have developed a post-mortem strategy, taking advantage of the structure of the shell at its growing edge. So here, the scanning electron microscopy image shows again the structure of the shell at its growing edge. You recognize these units I have introduced previously, the so-called prisms. And if you look closer to the shell, to the growth shell border, you can see actually that at the very edge, the units are more rounded and well isolated. This is what we are calling the disc. These are the early stage of the units, the crystalline unit. Here in the intermediate stage, when the discs are growing and touching each other, they start to present a polygonal shape. And in their mature stage, they have their final polygonal, fully polygonal shape. If you look now at the structure of the shell across the thickness, you can see that the thickness is increasing when you are going away from the growing edge. So these two structural characteristics indicate that there is a footprint of a temporal process directly observable into the structure of the shell. So by looking at this different structure, either as a function of the distance to the shell border or as a function of the thickness, we should be able to get some temporal snapshot from post-mortem sample. So the calcareous biomineralization project onto which this talk is based is granted by the European Research Council, and it's very, very nice and very exciting project because it's gathering different fields of expertise. So we at Institut Fresnel, we are developing optical and X-ray microscopy approaches together with coherent Raman microscopy. We are also working in this project with a group at IFREMER who is developing ecophysiology approaches and omics. And we are also collaborating with a group at CEA at NAMBE in Saclay with specialists of physicochemistry approaches. So this provides us with a unique set of samples starting from fully controlled biominerals to biosynthetic materials. The group I am leading at Institut Fresnel, the COMICS team, is specialized in coherent optical microscopy and X-ray approaches. And my two colleagues, Marc Alain and Patrick Ferrand, that you can see here, are respectively developing inversion approaches and optical microscopy. I am more focused on coherent X-rays approaches. However, we are working, the three of us together, on the different side of this project. And this project has allowed us also to gather a young group of very skilled researchers, developing optical microscopy approaches or X-ray microscopy approaches. So let's start with the chemical analysis results that I want to show you. And this is based on the pair distribution function approach. So the motivation for this work results from the following observation. So using coherent Raman microscopy imaging performed on the shell growing edge, we could see such a characteristic map. So we observe this kind of map very, very often. So you could see here bluish prisms corresponding to fully crystallized prisms made of calcite. And you can see at the very edge, the units are more whitish, reddish, corresponding to a significant amount of amorphous phase. So amorphous calcium carbonate precursor has already been observed in several calcium carbonate biomineralization spaces. So this is not fully new. What is more new here is the fact that it is observed in the Pinctada margaritifera, and this motivates us to understand a little more what's happening. So in order to do that, so it's a study which was developed by Tilman Grunewald, who is a postdoc. Know him. So in order to do that, Tilman has proposed to use X-ray total scattering microscopy approach in order to extract the amorphous contribution of present in this shell. So to this aim, we are measuring the diffuse scattering intensity function as a function of the scattering vector. And we are extracting from the diffuse scattering intensity function the pair distribution function, which tells us about the atom distances into the material. So you can see here different peaks, which are characteristics of different atom distances. So the difficulty here is to extract the amorphous contribution from a material that we know to be a crystalline sample. So how to extract the amorphous contribution? So in order to do that, we have taken advantage of the fact that a Bragg peak only exists if the sample is in Bragg condition. So by rotating the sample along its rotation axis, we will be able to go in and out the Bragg conditions, and therefore we will be able to discriminate the crystalline contribution from the amorphous contribution. So this experiment was done at ID15 at ESRF using a 60 keV beam in order to catch a very large portion of the reciprocal space and using a small beam with a typical width of 500 nanometer. And so all the diffraction patterns were collected along the rotation angle here, omega. And they were compared one with the other in order to remove the crystalline contribution. And different additional mathematical operations were done in order to perform the angular integration and extract the diffuse scattering intensity function. So you can see here the fluorescence map observed acquired on the samples and two line scans which were done with this approach. And here on this red and yellow square-like pattern, you can see the succession, the successive intensity diffuse scattering curves extracted from this data set. And you can already observe a very nice consistency between these data sets. So in order to go further, this diffuse scattering was transformed into a pair distribution function as a function of the scan position. You can see some of them here. And in order to analyze this pair distribution function and as a first try, we decomposed the pair distribution function into its principal component. And we observed that three main contributions were sufficient to describe most of the changes and most of the characteristics of the pair distribution functions. So these three main components are shown here, the blue, the orange, and the green curves. And I will rely on this description to this for the next analysis. So here I'm showing the contribution of each of these blue, orange, and green curves as a function of the scan position along the horizontal direction, this is the red curve, and along the vertical direction, this is the yellow pattern here. And what is very striking for the red line scan, for the horizontal line scan, is that you recognize very well the shape of the central crystalline unit here, or the biominerals unit here, which is very visible here. And you can straightforwardly assign the blue contribution to the periostracum, which is this membrane, which is underlying the shell. Another interesting feature is the fact that inside the biomineralized units here and there, you can observe in the horizontal and vertical lines different characteristics which are similar in this biomineralized unit. So this unit is characterized by the fact that the orange contribution is much larger than the green one, as you can see here and there. On the contrary, when you are looking at the result obtained in older prism here and there, corresponding to this part and this part here, you can see that the green contribution becomes much more prominent with respect to, on the detriment of the orange one. So this shows that the amorphous phase that we are measuring is presenting different behavior depending where you are at the sample, in the periostracum, in the younger prism, and in the older prisms. And this is very interesting to notice already that the difference between these different principal components corresponds to a shift of the first peak here, which corresponds to the calcium oxygen distance. So we have the younger prism seems to exhibit a smaller calcium oxygen distances into this amorphous phase. So as a conclusion to this first set of results or experience, we were able to evidence the presence of an amorphous phase in this crystalline sample and in this pearl oyster shell, we observe that the amorphous phase is presenting different characteristics depending if the young or older prism is probed. And in order to go further, we are now developing reverse Monte Carlo analysis to identify the different atom-atom bond lengths. This is a work in progress, and we will be pleased to present this result in the near future, I believe. So now let's switch to the second kind of analysis we are doing. So crystalline, the analysis of the crystalline properties using two different kinds of approaches, nanodiffraction and typography. So in order to do this crystalline analysis, the scheme of the experiment is in its essence very similar. The sample is put into a translation and rotation stage, illuminated by a focused beam, and the diffraction pattern are measured either very close to the sample or further away from the sample. The main differences with the previous experiments are here. So this experiment was done at ID13 at ESRF using a beam with much lower energy, a 50 kV beam. And two different modes were used. Either we used the full beam in an incoherent mode, or we use part of the beam in order to extract only the coherent part of it for all the coherent diffraction imaging approaches. And so the information we are gathering are shown here. So this is a diffraction pattern. You can see the well isolated and defined Bragg peaks. And actually, we are looking at a finite number of peaks here, but we are analyzing them in 3D, meaning that we are acquiring this diffraction pattern along the rocking curve, along this rotation angle here. And the three-dimensional diffraction pattern were analyzed in order to extract both strain and tilt. And here, the beam is about 80 nanometers, so it's a very, very small beam, and we are scanning the sample across the beam in order to get all this information for each position into the prisms or the disk. So the first results I'm showing you here corresponds to the 113 Bragg diffraction peak obtained onto a disk at the very border. And this is the result of the analysis. So you can see the integrated intensity onto these disks. It is quite homogeneous. However, when you look at the strain, you observe something which is quite striking. You observe a ring-like pattern here, which corresponds to a contrast of strain. Another interesting feature comes from the observation of the Bragg peak as a function of the position along the disk radius. So at the very border of the disk, the Bragg peaks are usually very simple. It's a single Bragg peak, very well defined. On the contrary, when you go closer to the center of the disk, the Bragg peaks becomes more complex, elongated, and sometimes structured. So it is even more striking here in this example, in this second unit, which is a prism, so an older crystalline unit, where you recognize here part the ring that was very well visible on the disk. Here it's only a part of the ring which is discernible, I would say. And again, if you look across the prism as a function of its radius, you can see how the Bragg peaks is evolving as a function of the position. And you can even do some signal analysis and estimate the number of Bragg peaks for each of the position onto the prisms. And you can see that at the very border, the number of Bragg peaks is very small, while closer to the internal side of the shell, the number of Bragg peaks is clearly increasing. So this first set of results have shown that you have a strain contrast which presents a ring-like shape, and we believe that this is an indication of a radial crystallization front, and these results are also confirmed by other approaches. And the observation of increasing number of bright peaks across the prisms is an indication of a stacking of crystalline layers, each of them being slightly different with respect to crystallite orientation. So in order to go further into the analysis of the crystalline properties, I'm presenting now results of Bragg tachography approaches. So Bragg tachography, it's a tachography imaging approach performed in the vicinity of the Bragg peak. So it's a method that we have, that we are developing for a long time, that we have demonstrated at different beamlines, at different synchrotrons in the world. So ESRF, ID1, ID13, Soleil, APS, NSLS2, and MAX4. You can probably go to these articles here if you want to go further, if you want to know further on the approach, on the techniques related to this approach. I won't go too much into the details here. I can just tell you that this approach is based on the measurement of coherent diffraction patterns. Some of them are shown here, acquired as a function of the position onto the sample and as a function of the angle along the rocking curve. And we are using this set of coherent diffraction pattern to retrieve using an inversion algorithm to retrieve the sample scattering function in 3D. So the inversion algorithm is a little bit more complex than the one that you are seeing here, but it's very, in essence, the idea is here, and you can probably go to this article if you want to introduce yourself a little bit more to, if you want to understand a little bit more on the technical details of these approaches. So here, the result I'm showing now focuses on a very small part of the investigated prisms, because these experiments, they are very, very interesting. They are providing a full of details, but they are highly time consuming. So the area that I want to show you, the volume I want to show you, is very small with respect to the prisms. However, we could get already some very interesting results. So this is the orientation map obtained into this yellow volume here. And what is striking here is that the volume we are investigating is actually composed of different orientation domains. You can see here the different orientation domain spanning an angular range of about 1.2 degrees. And we can also extract a similar map regarding now the strain. And again, we are observing that this crystalline material is composed of domains of isostrain. So we have isostrain and iso-oriented domains. Another important characteristic or properties that the Bragg tachography is able to provide is the information regarding the crystalline coherence, and in particular, the crystalline coherence length. So the crystalline coherence is the length onto which a crystal is replicating similar to itself without being interrupted, without being disturbed. So here I'm presenting results from two different volume into the prisms, and this result shows consistency. So you can see here this color map corresponding to the crystalline coherence volume. So an homogeneous color indicates that the crystal is coherent. And in both cases, what you are observing is that the crystalline coherence is much larger than a granule size. However, the coherence is smaller than the prism thickness. So we are now trying to gather all this information regarding crystalline analysis, and in particular, what we are learning on the crystallization front in the plane of the prism. So the fact that the crystalline coherence is extending over several granules is a signature that we are not in presence of a solid-solid transition between already crystalline granules. On the contrary, we can invoke the presence or the formation of an amorphous to calcite transition through a dissolution reprecipitation process or an oriented attachment of single crystalline particles with the hypothesis that they are fusing together. Regarding the crystallization front along the axis of the prism, so in the longitudinal direction, the number of Bragg peaks and the fact that we have domains of strain and orientation and finite coherence lengths tells us that we have this layer by layer growth mode. So this is not a novel information, but here we are observing that there is a partial preservation of the crystalline characteristic, which could be related to an epitexture growth on an organic intermediate layer, for instance. So this is time for me to conclude, I believe. So I hope I could show you that we could gain a physicochemical insight and we can progress on the physicochemical pathways using X-ray beam regarding calcareous biomineralization. So we have identified these amorphous precursors and we have observed that it evolves with the state of the biomineralized units. And regarding the layer by layer growth mode, we are observing that there is a continuous crystallization front along the prism surface, while along the prism axis, the crystallization is not that continuous. So this was only possible because we had microscopy approaches and chemical and crystalline information. So thanks to the use of X-ray coherent and incoherent nanobeam. However, we are aware that in order to provide or to propose robust conclusions, we need a bio-inspired systems with very well-controlled synthesis condition to be able to fully describe the crystallization process. We have also identified a series of difficulties or open questions. So first, statistics on biological samples could be an issue when you are using X-ray synchrotron sources. And with this respect, fourth generation synchrotron will help. For instance, we used to need like 8 to 10 hours to perform a Bragg typography, a three-dimensional Bragg typography microscopy acquisition. And now we can do it in a few tens of minutes. And we are combining also these X-ray approaches with lab-based approaches to gain information onto the statistics. And finally, as I told you, this approach is a time shot only, and we are making efforts, strong efforts, to develop in vivo approaches. So I would like to thank you all for your attention, and I would like to acknowledge my colleagues who have participated to this work at Fresnel, Comics, and also Julien Duboissier. At ESRF, Manfred Bogamer, who is welcoming you for years now, and other colleagues at ID15, also our colleagues from IFREMER, and our colleagues from CEA, who are fully involved into this project. Other persons are different synchrotron sources, and some colleagues from GEOPS Lab. So thank you very much for your attention, and I will be happy to answer questions.
Great. So thank you, Virginie. That was a very nice presentation.